So from coast to coast, artists of color face challenges breaking in and breaking down cultural inequities. They're often underrepresented on the walls of galleries and in the offices of leadership. But there's a new program that's giving voice and space to artists and art activists.
It's called the Intercultural Leadership Institute. And joining us so we can learn more about it is ILI fellow Betty Yu, an artist, educator, and activist. And welcome to BK Live, Betty.
Hi, how are you? Thank you for having
me. First class. She's the inaugural fellow round. Welcome.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
Okay, can you tell us a little bit about your background and how does this fellowship help with the work that you aspire to do?
Sure. So I am born and raised in New York City. I'm from Sunset Park, Brooklyn, not far from the studios. And my family still has roots there. And I've been doing immigrant and labor organizing for a very long time. And in the last 5 years, taking on issues of gentrification in Brooklyn and Manhattan, and particularly in the Chinatown. So not only Sunset Park Chinatown, but Manhattan's Chinatown. So I helped co-found Chinatown Art Brigade. And basically, our brigade works with a group called CAV, Organizing Asian Communities in Chinatown. And they have a tenants union in Chinatown to protect tenants from evictions and displacement. And what we've done over the last year and a half, 2 years, is we've been doing live projections at night onto buildings in Chinatown with The Illuminator, which is an artistic cultural collective. And we've been projecting anti-gentrification messages, sending a very clear message. Sending very clear messages to gentrifiers and gallerists. We have over 120 galleries in Chinatown that have moved in the last 5 years, not meant for the working class, low-income immigrant tenants in Chinatown. So it's bringing a whole new demographic of people into Chinatown. So our businesses, bakeries, restaurants, groceries are out, right? So it's catering to a new demographic of people. Mm-hmm. And not that we don't want them there, right? It's not just about the individuals, but for them to understand the impact that they're having when they move into a working class community, mainly of non-English speaking immigrants in Chinatown. And so
I'm saying we're absolutely going to bring it back to the arts, but you sparked so many things. I wondered, we spent a lot of time here talking about gentrification and its effects. Mm-hmm. I wondered, where are the people who are in Chinatown and Chinatown, where they're being displaced to?
Yeah.
Like, where are these populations going when an art gallery moves in?
Yeah, a lot of them.
120 of them.
Because, exactly. So many of them who already live in deplorable conditions in these tenement buildings, and their landlords, sometimes Chinese, are kicking them out. They move to satellite Chinatowns like Sunset Park, by Avenue U in Brooklyn. Okay. Oftentimes they will move to Flushing, which is, you know, way out in Queens, and then other satellite Chinatowns pockets of Chinatowns in Queens and scattered throughout Brooklyn. But I would say that when I applied for the Chinatown Art Brigade fellowship with the Intercultural Leadership Institute with ILI, I had a very focused mission, which was to really figure out how do we learn from other organizations, cultural and artist organizations, and cultural workers and artists and cultural bearers, to figure out how we can, because part of my job is not just I'm representing myself, but I'm representing the community in Chinatown Art Brigade. So how am I a vessel in bringing back that information to the larger community in Chinatown? Because often people in Chinatown feel very isolated. You feel like discouraged. You feel like this is something that you're only facing, even though you know you're not the only ones facing it.
Right.
What I love about ILI, as you mentioned, it was started by four organizations, the Pai Foundation in Hawaii, the First Peoples Fund, which is a Native Peoples Fund, First Nations Fund, Alternate Roots, which is based in the South. It's a Black-run, led arts organization from the South, as well as NALAC, which is the National Arts and Latino Association. And those four groups
have been in the fight for a long time.
I just want to ask this. I mean, all these four groups sort of come together, and they say there is a dire, dire need for more. And so they put out this fellowship, hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of applicants. Mm-hmm. They only pick 30 people, two from New York.
Yeah.
You're one of them. How does it feel to know that your life work is just that important that it's getting the backing and the funding to continue.
Yeah.
Because not everybody gets that.
Yeah, no, I was really shocked when I heard the amount of applicants that applied, which makes sense. They all have a great reputation, the organizations, that is. I'm feeling very lucky and really privileged and humbled to be in the space. Our first meeting was a couple of months ago in Jackson, Mississippi. And I really have to say that the fact that they are centering Black and brown voices and artists, specifically Black communities, Native, Indigenous, and Native Hawaiian voices and Latino voices. But the fact that, you know, they've never been, it's a very Black-centered space, and I think that's really important.
Jackson,
Mississippi, and then we go to Lakota Territory in South Dakota, where folks who have been fighting the Dakota Pipeline will be coming from Standing Rock also to join us. But I think that's so important, because if anyone's been the most disenfranchised in this country, it's Black communities, Indigenous folks in this country, no doubt. And the fact that they've centered that, and that's the way we're kicking off the whole entire institute, is so vital and important. I learned so much in Jackson, Mississippi, around the cultural organizing piece and how they're working with the low-income community in Jackson. Jackson is 80% Black, and you know, about to elect a really radical mayor again, right? The son of Chokwe Lumumba, and I'm really excited about that. I feel like it's such an important moment, given the political climate we're in with the Trump agenda, to have fearless cultural and arts leadership to shepherd us forward in this fight.
We have about one more minute left.
So tell us what you're going to do with this platform and the resources of your fellowship.
Yeah, so basically we're going to be meeting a few times throughout the year, Hawaii in 2018, Lakota Territory in the fall. And basically the mission is for us to not only have a cultural exchange and to learn from one another, but to deepen our relationships as diverse cultural communities coming together. So not just as individuals, but all of us are working on issues around immigrant rights, around housing, around racial justice, climate justice, you name it. And so it's not just about the individuals coming together, but how do we actually do it in a really meaningful way where it's people of color led, where it's led by the people who are most disenfranchised and impacted by social injustices in this country. And so for me, it's really exciting, because throughout the next 2 years, we're going to be doing all of that and building, whether it's virtually or just physically, in the same space. Yeah. And all of us, the whole mission is to bring this back to our own community that we're organizing in, doing art and justice work in, to enrich it. Absolutely.
And all right, so you just elevated everything. because you're holding it down and got the fellowship going around the world and bringing it right back to Brooklyn. So thank you.
Thank you.
You have to come back with the work.
Yes, that'll be great. Thank you.